Hi, I'm Richard Green. I'm Executive Vice President and General Counsel of EMI Christian Music Group. I'm responsible for all of the legal matters that involve our company, as well as Capitol Records Nashville, for which we also do all of the legal work. I started out actually wanting to be a corporate or securities or tax lawyer, like I think most people my age at that time wanted to do. In fact, I have a master's degree in tax law from New York University. In 1973, I moved to San Francisco, where just by circumstance, I ran into a lot of artists. At that time, the artist community in San Francisco was huge. In meeting with some of these artists, I became friends with them, and they were looking for legal representation. At that time, there were not a lot of entertainment lawyers in San Francisco. Most of them have always been based in Nashville, which is where we are now, New York City, where I'm also admitted to the bar, and California, where I am also admitted to the bar. So in meeting these artists, that's how I really began my career in the entertainment business. I started in 1973 representing a lot of artists in the music business, more of the creative side. Over a period of time, I also began to do a lot of work for various record and music publishing companies, and I made a determination at a certain point in time that working with record companies and music publishers and entities, so to speak, was a lot more consistent. Frankly, as a lawyer being paid on a regular basis, I could count on getting retainers from these kinds of clients. And I just felt that I was more in tune with working on the corporate side of things as opposed to working on the creative side of things. My job is essentially to oversee all of the legal issues that our company faces, which are, in this day and age, myriad. I deal with the leadership team of the company, of which I am one of the members. Virtually any major legal issue that affects our company, from recording contracts to music publishing contracts to copyright issues to lawsuits to trademark issues to new media issues, all of those kinds of things, they come my way. They can come by way of department heads. They can come by way of people who deal in special markets areas. It can happen. Almost everybody in this company is in one way or another a client of mine and my department's. And by the way, my department comprises 7 people. We have 4 lawyers, including me, 2 assistants, and we have 1 licensing person who reports directly to one of my direct reports, from whom we get licenses for musical compositions and master uses. The problems with new media that we're facing, well, they're really twofold. First of all, there's a whole body of law which we're developing really as we grow. Congress gives us a lot of information. They give us a lot of laws. And then it's our job to try to interpret what to do. There's also a lot of holes, not intentionally, but there's a lot of holes in terms of rates and things like that, that Congress does not deal with specifically. They feel instead that the marketplace will justify how rates are determined between artists, record companies, music publishers, and so forth. And so those things are left for us to negotiate, and they're not always easy to negotiate because everybody has a different point of view on the law and what the rates should be depending on what their positions are. So we have that issue. That's a bona fide business issue which exists between us and the artists that we deal with, the music publishers that we deal with, the various cable TV and television networks that we deal with, the programming people that we deal with. Those are sort of our everyday, this is what we have to learn how to do, and we're learning as we go. For the most part, there is a lot of cooperation in the business. There are times when there is not a lot of cooperation, and that's not really anybody's fault. Everybody's got their own point of view about these kind of things, and they're all legitimate as far as I'm concerned. We are the market leader in our industry. We not only have a record company, we also have a large music publishing company, so I get to be on both sides of these kinds of issues a lot, and I tend to understand the point of view of both the recording side and the music publishing side, and try to act as an intermediary when I'm negotiating these rates, depending on, you know, what kind of company I'm negotiating them with. That's sort of the easy side of things. The more difficult side that we've had to face is the area of piracy. Forever, we've had the issue of physical, or what we would call counterfeit goods piracy, This is a huge area that exists every place in the country. There are manufacturing plants which are illegally manufacturing the goods of virtually every record company and every artist in the world. And those goods are being transported throughout the world and sold at all kinds of places at cut-rate prices, which means that the artists, the record companies, the music publishers, the songwriters, and so forth, receive no income from these usages. That kind of piracy has been going on for many years. The Recording Industry Association of America, which is the trade association for the record business, has been dealing with these kinds of issues for us for many years. I am on the legal committee of the Recording Industry Association of America, and we're constantly trying to figure out how to stamp out piracy on a worldwide basis. It's very difficult. Do I think it's ultimately possible? The answer is no. Do we try to limit it as much as possible? The answer is yes. It's a huge job. However, with the advent of the internet, we're dealing with a whole new area. We're dealing with an area where people can go in the privacy of their homes and they can download songs that they get from certain sites that have not been licensed by any of the record companies, the music publishers, the artists themselves, and they can... In downloading, they can do this in the privacy and secrecy of their homes and feel, as opposed to walking into a store, we often like to say, excuse me for digressing a moment, you know, we often like to ask people, well, what if you walked into a record store and you walked out with a record in a jewel case, shrink wrapped, would you consider that stealing? And of course, in most cases, and I say in most cases, people think, yes, that's stealing. Somehow they feel that if they're doing it in the privacy of their homes and it's something that's over the airwave, cyberspace as we call it, that's not really stealing. This is a big problem. We have a huge ethical, possibly educational issue. It starts, in our opinion, probably with kids maybe 11, 12, 13, and it goes up through the colleges where we find that there's huge amounts of peer-to-peer file sharing, which is almost impossible for us to stop, but nonetheless, we are forced to try to stop it. And I think this is the biggest area in the future for us to try to teach people that ethically, taking a song, taking a film, taking a book, if you will, off of the internet and not paying anybody for it is no different than walking into a physical establishment and actually walking out with a physical embodiment of that piece of work. In my position with the RIAA, I am more involved in meeting with members of Congress. 2 weeks ago, I had a meeting along with various members of the RIAA and various of our lobbyists of the record industry and music publishing lobbyists, songwriters, and so forth, with the Attorney General of the state of Tennessee, who was absolutely marvelous. And he told us that he would do whatever he could to help us, but he's really only able to help us from what they call the bully pulpit in politics. He's not able to help us from a law point of view because most of copyright law, of course, is federal, and this federal preemption of state copyright. So we have to deal with these kind of issues more from the educational side of the, in this case, of the Attorney General, perhaps going to the University of Tennessee, going to various of our other state universities, even some of our private universities, and trying to explain to them how what they're doing is not only, from our point of view, what we would call stealing, it's also affecting revenues. When you talk about the amount of units around the world, or in this case, in the state of Tennessee, that have been downloaded without authorization and without monies passing hands, you're talking about a tax base that is probably in the millions, if not billions, of dollars on a worldwide basis, where the money is not going into state government, and therefore all kinds of state services, I think, are actually being disserved by the amount of money that could be going into them to take care of people, whether it's the 10 care problems that we're facing in Tennessee, and many states are facing those kinds of issues of what do you do about Medicaid on the state level and taking care of people, issues of adoption, you know, state agencies that help children find foster homes and so forth. Money that ought to be put into taking care of people at the government and people level, we're losing a lot of it. People should remember that the record industry and the music publishing industry is one of the very few industries in the United States that actually brings positive cash flow into the United States instead of cash flow going out of the United States. So we're actually doing a huge disservice not only to our songwriters, our companies, our recording artists, we're doing a huge disservice to state agencies, federal agencies, and our government, because we're losing a huge amount of money that could be used for much more important purposes, even than, you know, the record companies making money. Well, the record labels, what we are doing through our trade association, which in the United States is the Recording Industry Association of America, the RIAA, located in Washington, D.C. Around the world, the agency, the like agency in most of the rest of the world is called the IFPI. But for all intents and purposes and for this conversation, they are one and the same. We have investigators, we have people who are searching the web, we have people who are trying to find the people who are doing this. And what we have begun to do in about the last 3 or 4 years is we have begun, and everybody knows this because it's been in the newspapers, we have begun to file lawsuits on a fairly regular basis, primarily against uploaders. In other words, the people who are taking their albums and uploading them onto the internet so that other people can copy those albums free. We have filed probably a couple of thousand, there may be more. I don't really know because I'm not involved on a day-to-day basis with the number of lawsuits, but we've probably have been filing the last couple of years maybe 700 a month in the United States. Most of these lawsuits we either win or are being settled. In most cases, they're actually being settled and we're getting money. Are we making money on these lawsuits? No, that's not our purpose. Our purpose is to show people that downloading and uploading without payment to the people who pay money for records to be made, songwriters who are trying to earn a living from songs, artists who are trying to earn a living from being recording artists, we're trying to show people that everybody is losing out. And by filing these lawsuits, we're using them as a deterrent. And in fact, as much as we don't like to do this, it has proved to be a very effective deterrent in stopping online piracy. I have always tried to practice entertainment law for our company, and our company is known for this, and many other companies are. We're by no means exclusive. I think the ethics of what we do is very, very important. The ethics of how we deal with our artists and our songwriters is very important. The ethics of how we deal with the public is very important. I think that the ethics of how young people look at how they acquire music is very important. I don't equate music as the be-all and end-all of society, but I do think that the ethical view that people take towards counterfeiting and music piracy is really important, because someday the people who are online right now thinking that they can download music in the privacy of their dorm room or their home, someday those people are going to be the leaders of this country. And I think that if we don't learn to adopt an ethical base in the way that we do the things that we're doing now, in something that may seem very minuscule, like taking a record or a book or a movie off of the internet, I'm wondering what's going to happen to our country and to the rest of this world if we have someday people leading us who had no sense of the ethical understanding of these issues when they're in their teens and their 20s. And that actually is a major concern to me. Most law schools, as far as I know, do not have significant programs where, in effect, if you were in college, you'd call it a major, where you can major in intellectual property rights and music law. There are probably, in most of the major universities, major law schools, that is, there are probably one or two courses, maybe a few more, that you can take in copyright, trademark, intellectual property rights. There are even record business courses where they teach you about the negotiation of recording contracts and music publishing contracts, but they are not majors, so to speak. They are not things that you can find that much of. So most of the training of intellectual property lawyers, entertainment lawyers, really comes on the job as opposed to in law school. It's very, very hard. Now, there are some schools that offer master's programs. Southwestern University in Los Angeles, the Donald E. Biederman School there, which I'm actually a supporter because Don Biederman, who has since passed away, was a very dear friend and mentor of mine, so I'm a big supporter of that program. They have a master's degree in entertainment law. So for people who are really looking to further their education, I would suggest that. Locally in Nashville, we have Belmont University, which has a terrific music business course program. MTSU has Middle Tennessee State University has a terrific program. More on the, as far as I know at least, on the creative side for people who want to be music producers, engineers, and so forth. So there are programs in certain select universities that are available, and many times we take interns during the summer from these programs, and many times those interns turn out to be people that we hire when they're done with their schooling for full-time jobs. But that's how we learn about them. That's how we learn whether or not they know their craft and whether or not they might be interested in working for a company such as ours. Well, for me, I want people who can switch gears quickly. I want people who are quick on their feet. We have so many issues at play anymore. As I said, when I started in this business in 1973, we used to do, mainly recording contracts, music publishing contracts. We had copyright issues, trademark issues, but nothing of the variety of legal issues that we touch upon today. Of course, we had litigation then, we have litigation now. You're always going to have that. For me, I'm looking for people who are smart, quick study, learn on their feet. I give them documents to read. I want to see how quickly they can learn. I let them negotiate. The lawyers who work for me negotiate as soon as they start. I don't necessarily put a new lawyer in a negotiating position with one of the top outside lawyers in the business. We take our time before we put them in that position. But it's really a lot of on-the-job training that we're looking for. But I'm looking for people who are smart. I'm looking for people who are quick. I'm looking for people who love what they do because we do work a lot of hours here. I think that's as record companies and music publishing companies have downsized, which is another attribute or effect of what's happened through music piracy, we have fewer people doing more work all of the time. So I'm looking for people who are hardworking people and who are quick on their feet, quick studies, and who are able to switch gears from one type of matter to another very quickly. You know, you're always going to have recording contracts, and you're always going to have music publishing contracts. They've existed forever. They're going to exist forever. So they certainly need to know about those kinds of things. But I think that for somebody who's young and is very computer cognizant, they would be wise to really study new media law. I don't know where exactly they would get the training, but I would say that the area of new media, with things like iTunes, things like Rhapsody, the various subscription services, the downloading services, what we now have, what we call the MSPs, the mobile service providers, where you can download songs onto your phones. This is going to be a huge area of growth for our industry. We don't know really. There's a lot of controversy or questioning as to how long these things are going to exist. We're talking about single song downloads as opposed to whole albums, which of course is not exactly what record companies are looking for, but we are looking to fill any gaps we can for the lost revenue that we've had. So I think that the area of new media law is going to be an area where a lot of the young new lawyers who are very computer conversant should really focus a lot of their time and energy. I would try interning while I'm in school. I think that interning is really important. We have found over the years that hiring interns during the summer has enabled us to get to know them. We can move them around into different departments. They can find out the things that they really want to do, whether they like something that they... A lot of times, you start out in your profession and you think you like one thing and you're actually going to like a different area. We have people who might think they like marketing, but really what they want to do is publicity. People who think that they like publicity might want to be involved in the creation of album covers. They might want to become sound engineers. So I think that interning is a huge area of opportunity for people who are in school to find jobs during the summer with the various major and independent recording and music publishing companies. That's if you want to be in the music business. If you want to be in the film business, obviously it's film companies. And if you want to be in the book business, obviously it's with the various book publishers.